So in this final lecture, I want to just give you an overview or flavor of another kind of exact exponential algorithm. Whatever we have seen is also exact algorithms, but there was some parameter and we had a notion of feasible algorithm as some, you know, f of k times n to the c kind of an algorithm. But here, there are no parameters, or if you like, think of the input size as a parameter. Okay? So, we want to just, you know, we are looking at NP-hard problems, so we know only exponential time algorithms if we want to solve them exactly. But we want to think, we want to find better exponential algorithms, okay? Because exponential algorithm is also not just one brush. You can say in the region of exponential algorithm, there is n factorial, there is 2 power n, there is 1.5 power n, there is 2 power square root of n, 2 power log power 5 n, all kinds of functions are there. So I want to improve the naive algorithms and get some better algorithms. Okay, so that's the plan. And so we will look at these two examples in this lecture. There are, you know, this is also a reasonably recent, well-studied area. So let's look at the 3-sat formula satisfiability problem. We're given a 3 CNF sat, and I want to check whether the formula is satisfiable. The naive algorithm would be to try all possible 2 power n assignments and run through the formula and see whether that assignment satisfies the formula, right? We will improve this algorithm. And you know, what does improve mean? We don't expect a polynomial algorithm, but we will improve the base a little bit. I just give you a starting point, and then, you know, there are better algorithms which I will not be able to tell you. Another example, we will see this chromatic number problem. Given a graph, what is the minimum number of colors you need to color the vertices so that, you know, adjacent vertices get different colors? Yesterday we saw a very naive algorithm. If I want to test whether a graph is k-colorable, a trivial algorithm would be a k power n algorithm, or try all possible colorings. Once you fix a coloring, run through all the edges of the graph and check whether it is a proper coloring. And so if you did not know the chromatic number, you will start with 1, 2, 3, 4, and see the first time you get an S answer, you will know that's a minimum number of colors, and that takes k power n. Okay? So we will look at again an improved algorithm for this problem. In fact, we will give a 3 power n algorithm for any k. Okay? And that is not the best algorithm, but that's what I will tell you today. It's using simple dynamic programming. Okay? So let's start with 3-sat. Let's say I have a formula which looks like this, right? And I want to check whether it is satisfiable. So a naive algorithm is to, you know, set all these variables 0, set all the variables 1, change, try all these 2 power n assignments, okay? But first, let's see, well, let's say I look at the first clause, and then can you tell me there's no point in trying some assignments? Just by looking at the first clause, why are you trying all 2 power n assignments? 0, 0, 1. So x1 is 0, x7 is 1, x3 is 1. Is an assignment, regardless of whatever else for the rest, is not worth trying, because you're looking at the first clause. That clause is falsified by this assignment, that, which will falsify the whole formula. Don't bother checking, right? Now, how many assignments are there totally where x1 is 0, x7 is 0, and x3 is 1? No. How many assignments for x1, x2, xn in which x1 is 0, x7 is 0, and x3 is 1? Because these are the assignments you don't have to try, is what you are saying. 2 power n minus 3, because these 3 variables are fixed, everything else you have choices. So 2 power n minus 3, which is 2 power n by 8, assignments you don't have to try. So how much have we saved now? Instead of trying all 2 power n assignments, you are saying it's 2 power n minus 2 power n by 8. So it's 7 into 2 power n, 7 by 8 assignments are sufficient to try. Okay? But this is not an asymptotic improvement because we just saved a constant factor. But can I use this idea in some sort of a recursive algorithm and obtain an asymptotic improvement? Right. So, my branching algorithm, a trivial 2 power n assignment, if you want to translate and think in terms of a branching algorithm, it is trying x1 equal to 1, x1 equal to 0, x7 equal to 0, x7 equal to 1, x3 equal to 0, x7, x3 equal to 1. So, there are 8 assignments it's trying for these 3 variables. Instead, now you are saying try only for these 3 variables. Out of the 8 assignments, it's enough to check 7 assignments, right? Because in particular, x1 equal to 0, x7 equal to 0, x3 equal to 1, you don't need to try. So, consider the following branching algorithm, which works like this, right? So, for these 3 variables, x1, x7, and x3, normally I have 8 branching steps, 8 possible assignments, but now I am going to do only 7 possible assignments because, you know, one assignment is not worth checking. So, I try this. For these 3 variables, I am going to try any of these 7 assignments and recurse. What does that mean? Once I fix an assignment, these 3 variables go away in the formula. In the remaining formula, I continue and apply the same thing and see whether it is satisfiable by recursing one for each branch. Okay? So, I'm going to say recurse on the remaining variables. So, is the algorithm clear? Think of it as a branching assignment, branching algorithm which just says x1 is equal to 0, x1 equal to 1, x2 0, x2 1. Instead, now I am clubbing some 3 things together and instead of trying 8 assignments for them, I am going to try 7 possible assignments for them. And then recurse. So that means for each branch, these 3 variables go away. On the recursive formula, pick another class with 3 variables, try it, keep going. That's the overall algorithm. What would be the running time? It's a recursive algorithm. So let's write a recurrence relation for it. So what would be the recurrence relation? If I want to write this recurrence relation, T of n would be right. So, try this assignment for the 3 variables, recurse on the remaining variables. Try this assignment, recurse on the remaining. So, how many recursion steps? I can write a program. It's not a, so recursively check whether the okay. So let me say the way I would write is. Recursively check if the formula with x1 equal to something, x2 equal to something, x3 equal to something, or f with something else, or f with something else is satisfiable. That's the whole algorithm. If any one of these 7 things is satisfiable, the answer is yes, otherwise it's not. So, what would be the recurrence relation? 7 times T of n minus 3. Very good. Yes, right. So, 7 such problems and each of the problems, 3 variables are eliminated. Right, some plus some polynomial time. I'm just going to ignore that. You can always multiply by some polynomial thing to verify this, setting this assignment, simplifying the formula and all that. What is the solution to this? So let's try this one more time, right? One way to solve reconciliation is to bootstrap and expand. So this would be 7 into, what is T of n minus 3? 7 times T of n minus 6. So this is 7 square into T of n minus 6. Next time it will be 7 cubed into T of n minus 9. So finally when it will stop? 7 power, no, there is no log here. N by 3, exactly, right? Because every time you are, another way to think about it, what is the height of this tree? Branching factor is 7. What is the height of the tree? Because every time in one step, 3 variables are gone. So it will be N by 3 is the height. And so branching factor is 7. So the whole thing would be, so 7 power N by 3, which is 7 power 1 by 3 whole power N, which is some 1 point something power N. I don't know, 1 point. Because 8 power 1 by 3 is 2. Right? So 7 power 1 by 3 is something less than 2. So 1 point something. It's a very simple idea that we just said we don't have to try some assignments. We just apply it recursively. It gives you an asymptotic improvement. Now it's no longer a 2 power N. It's not some constant factor savings. It is some C power N for C less than 2. Okay? Is that clear? Now you can do some more clever things. Instead of a clause, you can pick a variable which appears this way, that way, and do some branching, various kind of things, and you can improve this. It's very similar to the vertex cover algorithm we were looking at, right? So it's just some starting point, and then you try and do more clever things. So the current best, for example, for 3-sat, is something like 1.5 power n. Okay, I'm just saying approximately, but I don't remember exactly, but something like this. So the game here is that we are stuck with exponential time algorithms because the problem is NP hard and we want to solve it exactly. But can we get better exponential algorithm, improve the base of the exponent? And so that's possible. There are a lot of different algorithms to improve this. So we just had a starting point and we can do more clever things and get better algorithms. Okay. And so here is also another interesting news for SAT, for general SAT. No 2 minus epsilon power n algorithm is known. We use the fact it is a 3 CNF SAT, which helped us to do some branching and cut down on the number of choices. But if it is a general SAT, there is no bound on the length of the clause, then currently there is nothing better than 2 power n known. Not even 1.999 power n is known. And in fact, it is believed that that's not possible. There is a, see, NP hardness just tells you that there is no, polynomial time is unlikely. But from polynomial time to exponential time, there is a big gap. How much is possible is the question we are trying to address here. And so there is something called strong exponential time hypothesis, which says it's like a conjecture, it's not solved. No 2 minus epsilon algorithm possible for general SAT. It's not proved yet, but just like P not equal to NB conjecture, this is also a conjecture. And again, people have used reductions from here and try and show, okay, under strong exponential time hypothesis, here is a problem which cannot be solved in this much time kind of reduction. These are some exciting recent developments in the area of algorithms, I would say. Okay, so that's it on 3-sat. Now I want to just move on to graph coloring and try and give an improved algorithm than k power n we had. Yeah. If there is only one variable, then, you know, you want to test satisfiability, you just check whether it's true or not, constant time, right? N is the number of variables. There is only one variable formula and you want to check whether it is satisfiable. Try the two assignments and check whether it is satisfied. So it's constant. Yeah, so it will be T of 1 is some 1 or something like that, okay, or constant. Yeah, okay. Then up to 3 is, or up to 2 is constant. Yeah, I mean, much as I say you need to give proof and you be precise and so on, I want you to be conscious that I am not being precise in many, many places because I'm trying to give a flavor, intuition, big ideas and so on. So don't think of this as the final word. Okay, this should help you to go read more things and understand for yourself. Okay, so here is another common question you should ask. So 3SAT has a very efficient algorithm, 1.5 power n algorithm, efficient. Suddenly our meaning of efficient has changed now because it's all relative, right? Because this general SAT doesn't even have a 1.99 power n, whereas 3SAT has a 1.5 power n. But remember, these are all NP-complete problems. So there is a polynomial time reduction from one problem to another. So can I not use a polynomial time reduction from SAT to 3SAT, use the 3SAT algorithm and get a good algorithm for SAT? What is the anomaly here that somehow 3SAT has a 1.5 power n algorithm, but SAT does not have? However, we could take SAT instance, reduce it to 3SAT in polynomial time, use a 3SAT algorithm and get back a better algorithm for SAT. Why not? Does the question make sense? Okay, so using the 3SAT algorithm and then putting back, yeah. Yeah, but good point, but these reductions are all polynomial time, okay? So in the exponential world, they get subsumed, doesn't play a big role. So you take your instance of SAT, in polynomial time are reduced to an instance of 3SAT, use the 3SAT 1.5 algorithm and get back 1.5 or whatever algorithm for SAT. Why is it not working out? Yeah. Don't think of it that way. I don't, 3SAT is just an example. All I'm saying is these are our NP hard problems. If one problem has a good algorithm, why can't I use it to solve other problem by using the polynomial time reduction? Yeah. Hmm?
In short, in other words, you would like to say that why can't we have a single complexity of one?
Yeah, sort of, maybe. I mean, because that's all NP completeness is about, right? I can use one algorithm, polynomial time algorithm, as a subroutine to solve and get a polynomial time algorithm there. So, why doesn't it lift for if I have a 1.3 power n algorithm for this problem, why can't I get a 1.3 power n algorithm for the other problem, yeah? May change, but they change. It may not be linear, it may not be, it may, you know, your instance of n can become n cubed here, n power 5 here for all you know. All you know is polynomial time reduction. So you have an n variable SAT, when you reduce it to 3SAT, it may become an n cubed variable SAT. So your 1.5 power n algorithm is actually 1.5 power n cubed, which is pretty bad. 2 power n is actually even better. Okay, so that's the reason, yeah. Okay, so now let me just move on to graph coloring in the last 15-20 minutes. And So I want to design a better than a naive k power n algorithm. Okay, in this whole world of exponential algorithm, we have exponential time algorithm. We want to do something better than something naive, right? So your input is graph, and I'm trying to find a chromatic number. Think of what is chromatic number. It is another way of thinking about it is that I want to partition the vertex set into independent sets. I want to partition the vertex set into minimum number of independent sets, right? So let's try and use some recursion dynamic programming to improve the algorithm. So suppose I manage to find one color class in this graph. In the optimum coloring, I manage to find one color class. That means one subset of vertices, and suppose I'm told that they get, it's an independent set, they get one color. Then what can you say about the remaining graph? That whatever the remaining coloring is an optimum coloring of the remaining graph, right? So I can write chromatic, so you know, you are familiar with this symbol, right? Chi of G, the chromatic number of G, I'm going to write as follows. 1 plus chromatic number of G minus S min over S contained in V, and S is independent. Do you agree with this? So, because if you take the optimum coloring, every color class is independent set. So, I'm just saying take one independent set. I'm going to try all possible independent sets anyway. Okay? Don't worry about analysis for now. So I take one independent set and say I'm going to give all these vertices color 1. Then go to the remaining graph and say give me an optimum coloring of that. Plus 1 is the total number of colors. Now, who tells me that this independent set will get color 1? I don't know. So I'm going to try all possible independent sets because I know that in the final coloring there is one independent set which get color 1. So I'm going to try all possible subsets. And the important point is that if I decide that this set has color 1, then the remaining coloring is an optimum coloring of the remaining graph. This is what is called the optimum substructure property, which is useful for dynamic programming. Right? It's like, oh, if you have a shortest path from S to T, then every intermediate thing is also shortest path between these two vertices. Okay? So it's something like that. So this statement I have written can be actually formally proved, right? Because you take the chromatic number, look at the partition, and pick the S as one color class, then you know that the number of colors used is 1 plus. For the remaining, it must be an optimum coloring, because if there is a smaller coloring, you could have used that. And conversely, you know, you can pick the minimum of this would give you a chromatic number. Okay? So the first observation is this kind of a recurrence relation. So is this clear? Right? Now, that's it. We will use it to design our algorithm, okay? But not a recursive algorithm, right? So this is sort of like a recursion, because I pick a set S, you can think of it like a branching. I pick a subset S, give a color class 1, and recursively solve G minus S. But that is going to be very expensive, and I don't know whether we had a session on dynamic programming here. We should have had that there is an important difference between, you know, overlapping sub-problems where it is convenient to compute solution for smaller problems and build them up. Okay? So what we are going to do is that somehow incrementally in a bottom-up fashion, I'm going to compute the chromatic number of all these subgraphs so that when I need it, I can just pull it up from a table rather than computing it all over. So, but I don't know these subgraphs because I don't know S. But it doesn't matter. I'm going to compute chromatic number of every induced subgraph of my graph. That's my goal. Using the same kind of a recurrence relation. Okay? So, chi of the induced subgraph on some subset S is the same thing, right? Is min over some S prime contained in S, S is independent in G of S, 1 plus chi of G of S minus S prime. So, you are familiar with the notation chi. Chi of G means it's chromatic number, and G of S means what? It's an induced subgraph on the set S. That means you take this subset of vertices, pick up all the edges between them. That's my definition of G of S. So, I'm going to do this in increasing cardinality of S. Okay? So, what am I doing? I'm going to find the chromatic number of every induced subgraph of the graph, starting from subgraphs having one vertices, subgraphs having two vertices, subgraphs having three vertices, and gradually go like this, and eventually I will get for my entire graph what is the chromatic number. That's the plan. Okay? This is how dynamic programming works. There is some sort of a recursive formulation, there is some sort of a table you compute in some incremental fashion. So, if I have a one vertex graph, just by itself, the chromatic number is easy, right? You just need one color. Okay? So, starting from one vertex graphs. Is everyone with me on this? Suddenly, I'm going to say end of the algorithm. This is it. This is the algorithm. There's nothing much going on here, right? Because I've written some sort of a formula to compute the chromatic number of an induced subgraph. You give me a set S, the chromatic number of this induced subgraph is pick all independent subsets of this set S in this, give one color to that independent set and compute the remaining optimum coloring. But the important thing is I am not going to compute this, because at the time when I need it, it is already available to me. I am just going to pick it up from there. Okay? Actually, this is the end of the algorithm. Now, I'm going to start working on the analysis. So, is that clear? Okay? So, whole idea is compute the chromatic number of every induced subgraph of the graph. From there, I will eventually get the chromatic number of the whole graph. Okay? That's the whole idea. So, how do I start? I start with one vertex graphs. I know the chromatic number. That is sort of the base case of the dynamic programming, because each one vertex graph has one color, is a color class. And when I go to two vertex or larger vertex graphs, I can apply this formula, right? Because this is a formula for any induced subgraph. So, if I have two vertex graph, I pick an independent set, which will typically, you know, if assuming there is an edge between the two, then I give one color class, and for the remaining, which will be a one vertex graph for which I already know the number. So, I just pick it up from my table and add it here. So, I am incrementally computing this big table. So, if you like, right, so I have this huge one, it's thankfully one dimensional array. It simply says, for every, so there is an entry for every S contained in V, and what I store here is the induced subgraph's chromatic number. Starting from, so this is a big array. Think of it as a big array, I am filling it up. Each cell corresponds to a subset of vertices, and the value there corresponds to the induced subgraph on the subset of vertices' chromatic number. So, I start from one vertex graph. So, this I keep filling it up. When I get to the two vertex graph, I keep filling it up. And eventually, I come here, I have the entire graph, I get the chromatic number. And how do I compute these guys? Using this formula. Right? Because at some entry of my array, I have a subset and I want to compute what is the chromatic number. I apply this formula. I try all possible subsets of that set, independent set, give color class 1, and for the remaining, I don't have to compute it because it is a smaller size set. It is sitting in my array. I pull out from there, add all of it, and find the minimum and store it in my tree. Right? So for a small graph, one can actually work through an example to see how I fill up this array. So that's finally when I complete, I have the last entry would be the chromatic number of the whole graph. Right? Now let's see how much time it takes. That's all is left. The algorithm is over because the algorithm just applies this recursive formula using dynamic programming and fills up the table in a bottom-up fashion. Clear? Okay. So let's see how much time it takes, right? So typically in a dynamic programming, how do we analyze the running time? Very simple. First, see how many entries you are computing, how much time it takes to compute an entry. Multiply that, you get the overall running time. Right? Because I am computing this big array. Incrementally, I am computing the chromatic number of every induced subgraph. Eventually, I get for the whole graph. Right? So how many entries am I computing in the whole array? No, you're going to the second step. First of all, how many entries am I computing in this array? No, I mean, I have written down. Each entry corresponds to a subset of vertices. So how many entries are there? 2 power n. Because for every subset of vertices, I go to the induced subgraph and its chromatic number. There are 2 power n subsets. So the number of entries I'm computing is 2 power n. Right? Number of entries I'm computing is 2 power n. Now for each entry, let's see how much time it takes because I'm applying this formula. So this is for each entry, right? This is how I compute, if you fix a set S, how do I compute this? Well, it is applying this formula. So I try all possible subsets of that set. Take one, add whatever this thing now I don't need to compute it because it is sitting in my array, so I add that number and compute the minimum of it. So the overall time would be the number of subsets of S. So how much will that be? 2 power cardinality of that set, but if you want to give a very crude upper bound, 2 power n. So overall running time would be 4 power n. Is that clear? So that's it. This is two formulas. So to compute, the important thing is I am not spending any time to compute this recursively because I've already computed and stored in my array. So I just have to pull it up from the array and add this number. So the amount of time I will spend is the number of subsets of that set. Okay? Which I'm saying crudely it's 2 power n, but I'll spend more time to carefully analyze it. But it's 2 power n for each entry. There are 2 power n entries, so there'll be 4 power n. It's much better than the k power n we had, because if you want to check whether a graph is, and if the chromatic number is 100, the k power n algorithm would take 100 power n, but this is regardless of whatever the chromatic number is, it's 4 power n, right? So I'm going to just for now say 2 power n entries each take at most 2 power n time. So overall, I'm going to say again O star 4 power n time to ignore some polynomial thing. So this is a nice cute dynamic programming algorithm to compute the chromatic number. Not really in 4 power n, it's actually 3 power n. We'll do I'll spend the next 5 minutes doing a 3 power n analysis. And regardless of the chromatic number, that's what is important, right? If the chromatic number is 50, 100, our k power n algorithm would have taken 50 power n, but this will compute it in 3 power n. It's simply using the recursive formulation and computing it in an incremental fashion in dynamic programming. Okay. So let's say, how do I do a tighter analysis? Okay, simply because if you are, and a 2 power n is not going to come in the early stages, the cardinality of S is small. And you are looking at subsets of that set, so that's not going to be 2 power n, that's 2 power whatever the set size is, right? But how do I carefully analyze it? So let's write this. What the overall time more precisely is, O star summation S contained in V 2 power cardinality of S. Right? Because to compute one entry for one subset S, you are looking at all subsets of that set, so that's 2 power cardinality of S. Okay? And this is what I approximated by, cardinality of S is at most n, so I approximated by 2 power n times 2 power n, and I said 4 power n. But let me just do a little more careful analysis. So what can I say? So this term, how many I element subsets are there? NCI. NCI. For them, how much time would you spend? 2 power I. So it's exactly NCI times 2 power I. Okay? Because for an I element set, you will spend 2 power I time. How many I element sets are there? There are n choose I subsets of size I for which you will spend 2 power I time. So it is this, you know, I going from 1 to n or something. And what is this? Why? It's a binomial. What is this? It's exactly 1 plus 2 whole power n. Right? A plus b whole power n, if you write it in binomial, substitute a equal to 1, b equal to 2, this is exactly 3 power n. Now, this has been improved considerably. Any questions? They're clear? You have a doubt? Is there a problem? Okay. So, in fact, you can do slightly better by saying that, you know, we are only enumerating over all independent subsets of the graph. In fact, you can look at maximal independent sets. And the number of maximal independent sets is smaller than 2 power n. In any graph, one can prove that the number of maximal independent sets, okay, this is another, okay, let's say, it's the same algorithm. Let me say, can be improved by enumerating over all maximal independent sets in each step. And using the fact that number of maximal independent sets in a graph on n vertices is at most 3 power n by 3. Okay, so this first step is not saying much. All it's saying is that at least one color class will be a maximal independent set. So instead of just trying any independent set, just run over all maximal independent sets. Okay? Now if you do that, this statement says that in any graph on n vertices, number of maximal independent sets is bounded by 3 power n by 3. Let's say, suppose your graph is a perfect matching, okay? Your graph itself is a perfect matching. How many maximal independence are there, independent sets are there. Two? Just two. Your graph is the perfect matching. And I'm looking for a maximal independent sets. How many are there? N by 2. Okay. Now, N by 2 is the size of a maximal independent set. That's the size of a maximal independent set. I'm asking how many different maximal independent sets are there? Okay, so this is your graph. So there are n by 2 edges here. How do I get a maximal independent set? I pick a vertex from here, vertex from here, vertex from here, vertex from here. Together it will be a maximal independent set. What? N square? No. So let me say again. How do you get a maximal independent set? From the first edge, pick a vertex. Which vertex would I pick? Any of them. From the second vertex, pick any of them. Third vertex, pick any of them. The last, sorry, second edge, third edge. The last edge, pick any of them. Together, they will give you a maximal independent set. So how many choices are there? Any of them. So there are two choices here. Two choices here. Two choices. 2 power n by 2. Right? Suppose your graph is a collection of triangles. How many maximal independent sets are possible? Three power n by three, because same argument. From each triangle, you can pick a vertex. And there are three choices. So it turns out that is the best you can have. So this 3 power n by 3. So you take any graph on n vertices, number of maximal independent sets is not more than 3 power n by 3. Okay. So now if you enumerate over all maximal independent sets, then in this step, it's not 2 power I, but 3 power I by 3. Because remember, this is all subsets. Instead of all subsets, we are doing all maximal independent sets. So it will be 3 power I by 3. And if you do the calculations, it turns out this will be slightly better than 3. Some 2 point something power n. Now this has also been improved. The current best stands at 2 power n using some more sophisticated techniques, inclusion, exclusion, some algebraic way of writing graph coloring. There are lots of nice techniques. And in fact, there is a whole book, small cute book on exact exponential algorithms. I haven't mentioned textbooks for many of this, but we will send it across maybe. So exact, we'll mail you if you want. Or you can always Google up. By Feder Fomin and Dieter Krash. The whole, very small book, lots of, some 10 chapters. Each one is some 5 pages, 6 pages, talking about some interesting technique, including branching and dynamic programming and all that kind of things. Okay, I think I will stop here. Hopefully you got a flavor of exact exponential algorithms. Thank you.